All right.
Is it amplified? No, I'm not amplified. Okay. It's on already, right? Testing.
Oh. Yeah. Okay, wait. You're using another one.
Sorry. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Okay. Test. Okay. Hi. So, as Michael said, I just got my private pilot license at the start of the year. So, yeah. So this card over there, a very expensive piece of card. Okay. So. Let's first talk about my motivation. Okay. So, about 2 years ago, I was given a joyride by a friend of mine. So, yeah, this here, this guy, his name is called Roger. So, yeah, friend of a friend. So, he gave me another friend a joyride at Senai at Johor. So, this was when I thought that, okay, maybe this is something that I want to try. So, I set a goal for myself and I said, someday I'll learn how to fly one of these. September 2017. Okay. So I did some research and I found that there was actually a Singapore flight school called Flight School SG. So what they do is that they have a simulator located here. It's at near Seletar Airport. So what you do is that you do some night classes, night theory classes, and some simulator lessons. So I took over a span of 5 months. This is part time. Then after that, right, this school has a partner school in the US. It's called San Diego Flight Training International. So this is where basically the theory is done in Singapore to give you the basic foundation. Then you go over to the US to do the actual practical flying, because flying in Singapore is very expensive. Okay. So I completed this program and I went over to San Diego on 14 November. So this was the training airport. It's called Montgomery Gibbs Executive. Yeah, so they have many airports like this in the US. Okay, so in this program, right, it's divided into separate several parts. Stage 1 to 3, you train for solo, train to fly the aircraft by yourself. Then you train to fly the aircraft from one place to another place. Then prepare for the final check, right, which is like a test, like a driving test, the final test. So in the solo, what do you do, right? Basically, they call this a zero to hero stage. From never touch a real plane before to able to fly a plane by yourself, which means the learning curve for this stage is really very high. So imagine you need to know how to do a pre-flight and post-flight, which means to check the aircraft, whether there's any problems. Airport operations, how to navigate yourself in the airport, like how to talk over the radio, how to maneuver the aircraft, and let's say there's an emergency, engine failures, right? What to do? So really a lot of work during this first stage. Yeah, so it's just some pictures, very nice pictures, right, over San Diego. Yeah, things you imagine you go to a new city, right? I get to see more of it over the air than I visit on the ground. Okay, so at the end of every stage, right, there's something called a stage check, which means like internal evaluation to make sure that you know what you're doing before you proceed to the next stage. So actually, I failed the first stage check, you know. Okay, just let me give you a quick description what did I fail in. So this was the airport I was in, Montgomery. I'm supposed to come over here. It's called the Alpine Training Area. So the typical profile for I'm supposed to bring the tester is like, okay, from the airport, I climb to 3,500 feet. I go over here, I maintain 3,500. I climb to 5,500 feet, and I go over to this training area. Then the tester will tell me to do certain maneuvers. Okay, so once I'm okay already, then he'll tell me, okay, bring me back. Then I'll do this. I'll descend to 4,000, keep descending all the way back to the airport. So this is called a test profile. It's like driving test, you also have a test profile. Okay, so the tester said at this position, climb to 5,500 feet when able. Because, right, he said that you're going to get to 5,500 feet anyway, right? Why not just do it here? And I just follow. Okay, then when my aircraft reaches this position, right, 4,750 feet, he said my controls and he failed me straight away. Okay, so I know that all of you all probably never see a map like this. So let me explain to you why. Because there's a concept of air spaces. So air spaces means that certain altitude to certain altitude, there's certain things you can or cannot do. So for this particular region, right, 4,800 to 10,000 feet is a special airspace. You need permission to go in. You cannot just suka-suka just go in. So because I'm already so close, 4,750, I was nearly going to breach the legal limit already. So the tester straight away, he failed me. Then at the debrief, we say that, why do you follow? I gave you an instruction, Why you never go and think? You just follow blindly, So I tell you to eat shit, you go and eat, So that was the point he was trying to drive to me, right? So this is the first lesson. Don't blindly go and listen to people tell you what to do. Even if it's a tester or instructor, you think carefully first. Yeah, very cruel, right? Yeah, but anyway, because I failed, I had to retake the test the next day. Same instructor, same tester, but he never tried this trick again. Okay, so after I finished this test, right, I can do the first solo. So the first solo, right, is the most like the memorable for every pilot, for every student pilot. And I will show you the video of that. So there's no extra. Sorry, can I lower the volume?
Information uniform, request taxi for 2 AS, close traffic, full stop. Student pilot for solo.
Cessna 2441, Echo, Montgomery Grand, runway 281, taxi via 3X, full stop, Bravo.
Juliet Hotel Bravo, 2 AS, 2441, Echo.
Okay, so basically how it works, before the aircraft can move off, right, the pilot must ask the ground controller for permission to go to the runway. Then the ground controller will tell the pilot, okay, please take this route. JH something, right, is the route to the runway. Okay, so in the interest of time, let's fast forward to my first takeoff, lah. Okay, so here I'm reaching the runway already. And I cannot just go. I need to ask permission. So this is called the pre-takeoff checks. I'm just checking some things.
Runway tower, Cessna 2441 Echo, holding short, 28 left, ready for close traffic full stop, student pilot for solo.
Okay, the 2441 Echo is the aircraft registration number. Yeah, I still remember this moment as if it was just yesterday. Can never forget. I think most of you, I never seen a aircraft taking off from the view of the cockpit, right? Every time see as a passenger only, right? So in this solo, right, you can see from the map here, right, just go right around the airport. Take off, go, and then land back. Do a few times. Okay, so I missed my first landing. And my first landing was very bad. I am very happy to show one. Okay. This is a tower talking to a police helicopter. And the traffic on the Cessna of final 211 is me. Yeah, very nervous at this one. Landing is the most dangerous phase of flight. You see, I haven't. Wait, I go to the wrong section. Wait.
Second landing.
This is second landing. Wait, You see this one? Yeah, this one, sorry. I read the wrongly. Okay, so this was actually my first landing. So, I bounce a few times, right? Then go around. This is called go around. That means I have to abort the landing. Yeah, so I take off again. So, you all saw the second. There was a second landing. So, the second landing was okay. So, this is called nearly crash and burn. because if I had reacted just a few seconds late only, right? Because what happens is the aircraft is bouncing like that. If I reacted a bit late, if the aircraft just tips down a bit too much, when the propeller hits the ground, it's gone already. The whole aircraft might flip over. So, yeah. So, lucky ah. Lucky. If not, I would've, probably wouldn't be here. Okay, so after I did that solo, right, it's called stage 2. I trained for cross-country solo. That means you fly the aircraft from my home airport to another airport. So this one is where there's a lot of work, like flight plan. Like, you see all this stuff, right? The maps and what, like how if I get lost, what to do. Then make certain special landing, takeoffs and landings. Okay, so see, it's not that simple. For example, let's say I want to get from this airport to this airport, right? I cannot just fly a straight line, because there's a military airport here. Then there are a lot of airspaces here. So the way to, you have to go around the airport. But the thing is, when you go around the airport, there are two ways to do it, right? You can go left or go right, right? So why one over the other? So there are a lot of considerations that go into planning. So I'll not talk so much about this, like all these considerations. But the main thing is that there's a lot of planning, and it's better to plan things properly when you are on the ground than to go up in the air, then you realize, shit, I don't have this information. Then it's not like you got take your phone and got 4G like that. Okay, it's fine, right? Okay, so again, there's a stage 2 check. And I feel this, you know, so I will show you. Okay, so I was at this position. Okay, the evaluator tell me, okay, please divert to here. Fly over to this place. So again, You see, this I'm at 7,500 feet. But due to a special airspace, 5,800 to 10,000. So it means that I cannot just maintain my altitude going like that. It'll be illegal. So I need to descend first. Okay? So then I told him I need to descend. Then the tester said, okay, sure, just descend. But the problem is when I descend, right, due to the wind from the north, right, by the time I reached 5,500 feet, I was at this position already. Then I proceeded on the same angle. Because you see, let's say the tester tell me to come here, right? I need to actually take out the map and take out the compass, and then go and find out how many degrees to come to this position. But I never go and recalculate. I assume that I was still here. And then I continue like that, and he failed me. Because if I come, of course, if I at this position, I maintain this compass heading, right? I won't reach this airport, right? I won't reach here already. Yeah, fail. Okay, so again, retake test. So yeah. Okay, so I reached stage 3. So stage 3 is basically like you are revising everything. Because this is preparing for a check, right? And I failed this thing again because my landings was very bad. So the tester didn't let me get through. So this was when I was quite demoralized. Okay, let me show you something. So this is actually an open secret. 80% of student pilots actually don't complete their training because of all this. My instructor said four factors. You need money, you need time, you need determination, you need aptitude. You lose any one of these, right? You can't get your license already. And it's so easy to lose any one of these. These things. And I come. Talk about that after that. Okay, so the thing is, I was almost part of this 80% because I failed this stage 3 check on 21st January. And at that time, I didn't know when I'll get another slot because it depends on whether the tester is free. And they only have one tester in the school that can do this special stage check. So on 26th January, right, I texted my instructor, is there a time limit on the validity of training? If I cannot complete, I come back on 1 to 2 years or 3 years from now, do I have to repeat all the stuff again? Then he said, no aspiration, I just need to build proficiency again. Because I was running out of leave, right? I took leave from my job, I was running out of money, and I had no, basically my patience was running out. So basically I lose so many of this stuff already. So, but they were quite understanding, they quickly arranged a stage 3 check for me the next day, 27 January, and I passed the stage 3. Then this was my instructor, he said, yeah, okay, this is my buddy, he went with me. So be ready to land the hell out of the airplane. I have 4 hours to make sure you're ready to pass. Because my check ride was 2 days later. And I passed the check ride on the first try. Okay, so these two were my instructors there. This was the buddy who came with me, also from Singapore. This was the check ride tester, the final test. This guy is a stage check instructor, the guy who failed me 3 times. And then this guy is an instructor in Singapore, the simulator instructor. Okay, so I didn't talk so much about the lesson, so now I'll come to it very soon. Okay, after I came back to Singapore, right, I joined Seletar Flying Club and I did several flights. Okay, so this plane is called the Piper Warrior. So I had to actually have a checkout because I never used this plane before. So an instructor had to teach me and evaluate me. Then I flew with Roger, the guy who inspired me to take this up. So I'm very proud to have him as my first passenger. Right. So now instead of he fly me, I fly him. Okay. Then after that, I took some friends. Then on Saturday, in fact, I flew from Malacca to Singapore, but with another safety pilot to help me, I flew my parents on Sunday. So yeah, quite a whirlwind 2 months for me lah. Okay, so come to the lesson. So you may think flying very easy, but flying has a lot of responsibilities. So there's a lot of words here lah, okay? But I feel that I have to include all of them because this is what's inside the rule book. Okay, so the pilot flying is usually called the pilot in command. This is actually a technical definition. So a pilot in command of aircraft is directly responsible for and is the final authority to the operation of the aircraft. Everything, you are in charge of everything. Anything goes wrong is your fault. Okay? So in case of emergency, right, the pilot in command may deviate from any rule from this part. That means I can break any rule in an emergency in the interest of safety. But of course, I need to answer later, like why I break this certain rule, must justify later. But you can. Right. If I want to land on the road, you know, engine failure, I also can do one. I can land on the beach, land on the water, yeah la, also can one. Right. Okay. So these are the first lesson is that make sure that everyone understands the situation. I like this quote given by someone. Everyone knows how to be a car passenger, but most don't know about being a light plane passenger. Right. Most people never step into a light plane before. It's totally different. It's not like sitting a commercial plane. So they depend on you, the pilot, for everything. Okay, so I may show you the video of when I flew my parents lah, the safety brief that I had to give them. Wait,
Okay, suppose like a passenger briefing with your right. Okay, so the seat right is okay, right? Okay, air vent, there'll be one below there. No fire extinguisher. Okay, the exits, right, there's only one exit for this. Later, after the engine start up, right, before it both up, you'll close.
Yeah.
Then you'll latch two, one here and one at the top.
Two latch.
Yes. So one, when the lever goes to here, the latch comes to here.
Okay.
Okay, that'll only open first. But after, when they say during an emergency, if I have to do an emergency landing, right, just before touchdown, right, I'll tell you to unlatch the doors.
Oh.
Alright, so in case there's a crash, right, this thing will not jam the door over there. Okay? Traffic, right, so later we go into one area, the northern part of Singapore. Okay, so there may be other aircraft there. So if you see other aircraft, right, then you just tell me. Okay? Then no talking during critical phases. So let's say during takeoff and landing, then don't talk. Or when the controller's talking to me, don't say anything. Okay, so then after you got any questions, this one. Okay,
Okay. See, you are own parent must give also. So it's not optional, it's actually required by law. Okay? So let me show you another part.
November 2180,
ready to taxi. Okay, this is I'm talking to the Seletar ground controller. This is at Seletar Airport.
November 2180, taxi via Echo Papa. Hold Echo 1 for runway 21. Okay, so runway 21, right, is facing this way. So I will go out. Let me tell you, I'll go out, I'll turn right again, then I'll go right to the end. Then the runway is taking off towards this way.
Okay, I don't think my dad really understand anything about what I just said lah. But yeah, but have to brief because people are just not used to this kind of thing. Okay, so another lesson I learned is a better paisei than wrong. Okay, so this was, I took my friends 1 week before this. So I let the video speak for itself. Okay. Okay, so in this, right, while I was already moving the aircraft, I received new taxi instructions. And you can see I was very nervous and flustered, you know. Yes, sure.
November 2180, Echo, do you require a run-up at the holding point? November 2180 Echo cleared Echo Charlie 5, Echo Sierra hold short, Echo Charlie 6.
Fast forward lah. So you can tell how nervous I was, right?
Number 80 Echo, Echo Charlie 5, coming up shortly on your left, confirm visual.
Number 180 Echo,
and make a left here, Echo Charlie 5, and then turn right, Echo Sierra.
Number 180 Echo, make a left here, then turn right, Echo Sierra.
Echo Sierra, Echo Charlie 6.
Full shot, Echo Charlie 6, number 180 Echo.
Okay, so just now I requested for progressive taxi. Basically means the ground controller is like my Google Maps. He's telling me to turn left, turn right, turn left, turn right. Instead of, he gave me the whole string of taxi routes, right, and I just go there myself. And this is a very embarrassing thing to do at the home airport. I mean, if you have a foreign airport, the controllers can understand, you don't know the way. But this is supposed to be where I'm based at, and I'm going to ask this kind of thing. You know? But better to be wrong, embarrassed than wrong. Because if I'm wrong, I'll be slapped with the pilot deviation. It means it's like they can revoke my license at worst case. Yeah, I don't think they revoke my license, but depends on the severity. So yeah, I just really had to do it. And it was the first time in my life I did that, progressive taxi. So in the end, I realized I need to plan and study the airport map more thoroughly. Yeah. Okay, so this one, another lesson that I learned was it's a stressful multitasking during landing. So plane are really a lot of multitasking work, especially during the landing phase, because landing is very critical. The aircraft is very low to ground and it's very slow. So one small mistake, you can just crash out already. So I show this this one. Okay. 31, 4, 9. Wait. This was the same flight. 1909. So here I was landing, right? Why I like to show this is because normally the tower don't issue instructions when you're so close to the final, but they never give me landing clearance, so I must go and ask. So end up, I have to go and talk to them, I need to process their instruction, I need to look outside, I need to look at the aircraft instrument, and I make sure that I descend at the proper rate also. So, that one was really a challenge, a huge challenge at this one. Lucky no problem with the landing. So I really learned to multitask very well, especially that one. Okay, I think I reached the end of my talk already. So this is the timeline for those who are curious. Like, people ask me how long did I take everything, right? So, it'll be full screen. Okay, so when did I set my goal, right? I set my goal on 30 September 2017 and I passed my check right 29 January 2019. So, in between, I really went through a lot of stages. So, I deliberately put these two photos. The day I set my goal to the day I got my license. It was a very long journey for me. Yeah, that's all. Any questions? Yeah. Girl, do I have any?
Wait. Questions? No? Problems?
Nothing? Yeah.
So there's one time when you were doing radio commission.
Yes.
Just simply reply with Roger. Why not repeat?
Sorry, why not repeat back?
Yeah.
Okay, so Roger instruction means I acknowledge the instruction, but I don't have to do anything about it. So if I need to do something about it, then I repeat back the whole instruction. Okay, the course, right, because it's under recording, right, I talk to you later about it. Oh, yeah, okay, fine. You know, no, because there's a lot of factors associated with the value. I don't want to give a value at that because it might give a wrong impression because it depends a lot of things. For example, it depends on which country you take your course at, okay? Which school you go to, and which curriculum you take, and what is your aptitude. So it differs greatly from person to person. Yeah, so you see sometimes I fail so many tests, right? So I can say it's more expensive than it should be. Then plus the part I took, right, there's certain curriculum, right, they don't need you to take so many state check. You can just go directly and take the final test. Yeah.
Yeah. You failed in the middle of the flight, right? Then what do you do? The instructor will take over.
Yeah, okay. So when I fail something, the instructor usually say my controls. During a test, if the instructor says that, tester says that, right, you straight away must let go. The tester will do something to make sure for example, I was too high, right? The tester will move the aircraft to a lower, safer altitude. Then he'll continue the test. So for that particular one, I will fail, but he will still continue to evaluate me for the other portions of the test. So next time when I retake the test, I only retake the part I fail. Any questions?
How many days of leave did you use?
Okay, so I left Singapore on 14 November. I came back 29 January. So I spent a total of 77 days in the US. So 77 days. So I took actually 3 years of leave. So in SP, right, you can actually carry over one full year of leave. And at the start of the year, you can take the entire year's leave. I know some companies, you have to earn your leave, right? But SP, you can do this. So from November to January, right? Okay, from November to December, I took 2017 and 2018 leave. In January, I took this entire year's leave. So combine 3 years in one shot. Very few companies can do it, but I read through it, then I asked my boss, said it's legal, but no one has done it before. Okay.
Are there a lot of people, Singaporeans, doing what you did, and if they are, what's the age range?
Okay, I'm not sure the numbers, but this particular school is not that big one. Only me and my friend went to. And the only reason I went there is because it's a partner school. So when I learn the simulator, I'm actually learning this airport there. So it's easier for me to transition. But there are many other flight schools in the US, so I think many Singaporeans also choose those routes also. Hard to say, I'm not sure actually. This the reason I stay as a hobby, but the future hard to say. I don't know myself.
All right, that's it. Thank you very much.
Okay.